Thank you guys again for coming. It's been a busy week, right? Especially 30 years, right?
Yeah,
guys?
Yeah.
Good. Welcome. It's just going to keep going uphill from here. Today is a very, very special day. As most of you know, and if you don't now, you're going to know, this is the start of our 40th school year. So 40 years ago, Joe had this idea that it'd be cool to kind of facilitate other artists' dreams to kind of turn their hobbies and passions into a profession. And that is the common ground that we all stand on today, which is really, really awesome. 40 years later, so many people have come through these, through this program, and it's really enriched the industry that we know and love. So I thought it'd be a good idea that we have a day that honored that, legacy. Since Joe passed in 2012, I think my class was the last class that was here when he was here. So now you guys, all you guys know his stories. And hopefully some of you guys had the good fortune to meet him if you met him, you know, before you came to school. And so with that in mind, we thought it'd be a great idea to do something called a Founders Day. And it's just to give you guys a little taste of the history of how this got here, how this whole thing came to be. It's really the reason why we're all in these seats in this room right now. And when thinking about that idea, one person came to mind. Enter Arlen Schumer. Arlen is a comic book historian. This guy knows so much about this art, it's gonna blow your mind. And I don't want to belabor the intro anymore because I've seen
what?
It.
Wait, don't shorten my intro for that.
It is awesome beyond awesome. It's really a treat. So this is the first time we're doing Founders Day, guys. And so I hope you guys enjoy it. Stick around after too because Arlen's got cool stuff. But without any further ado, welcome to Founders Day.
A newsstand in 1938 in New York City. Look at that bottom row, what do you see? But the very first Superman, Action Comics, 1938. It unleashes the onslaught of superhero characters, Batman, Captain Marvel, Captain America, Green Lantern, The Flash, and Hawkman, drawn by a teenager for DC Comics, who returns to the character 20 years later with his mature style on Hawkman, Sergeant Rock, Enemy Ace, Ragman, and the definitive Tarzan. Ladies and gentlemen, who is this artist who did these five iconic comic book characters? The Kubert School Media presents on inaugural Founders Day, celebrating the history and legacy of the one and only Joe Kubert. Thank you. This is my book that I did, the original edition in 2003, a book on the great Silver Age comic artists, of which Joe Kubert is obviously one of them. If you look closely at my cover, you can see inside, I made sure Joe was represented with two of his key characters, Sergeant Rock and Hawkman. You can see in my introductory spread how I put the two images there. Each artist had a kind of portrait, and then I ghosted another key image behind the type. So those are two out of the five key characters, and we all know Joe created many great characters, but I narrowed it down to these five. Now, where did I get the classic center image there that Joe drew in 1968 that appeared on this comic book page for DC Comics? A kind of a tongue-in-cheek autobiographical story that appeared in this annual that DC Comics put out in 68 to honor their great artists like Carmen Infantino, and Kubert got issue 3. Inside, he drew a couple of new pages that showed the reader what his history was in comics. And you could see here some of the characters all from the early 40s when he, like Infantino and Gil Kane, were teenagers working for DC Comics. But one of the characters he became associated with was Hawkman. And you could see, there's Joe's signature there. This is in the mid-40s or so. And you could see the way Joe's young style looked, like that Hawkman cover that I showed in my introduction. By the time we get to the early 50s, Hawkman had metamorphosized into this character. But by the early 50s, all the superheroes were dying out after World War II. Look at one of the last issues of All-Star Comics that featured all the DC superheroes. That issue is actually called The Mystery of the Vanishing Detectives. Why? Because in the very next issue, they vanished when it was changed to All-Star Western, as other genres other than superheroes began to take over the genre. The Western, horror comics started to take over superheroes. This is the second to last issue of Captain America's title in 1949. And science fiction, most notably the EC comics of the early 50s, took over the superhero. So young Joe Kubert, shown here in an autobiographical image he drew decades later, basically was looking for other genres like all the other great comic artists in the early 50s were looking to do. And he came upon a prehistoric character that he did called Tor. And this is 1953 or so. Here's the splash page to the first issue. One of the key things you'll notice, of course, first of all, is how indebted Kubert was, like everybody was, to the Wallywood science fiction art in the EC science fiction comics at the time. And you can see the influence in the dinosaurs. But also, look at the upper left corner, how Joe liked talking directly to the reader. And here he is in another issue of Tor with his partner, Norman Moore. They worked together in the early 50s. And this was different to have comic creators actually directly addressing the audience. So they were looking for other genres to conquer, and one of the things that they ended up coming up with were 3D comics. Joe and Norman Moore innovated the whole science of 3D comics with a license from Mighty Mouse, and that was the first 3D comic. And Joe and Norman innovated the whole idea of the red and green plates to give you that three-dimensional look. Of course, they also were able to get their favorite character, Tor, into 3D as well. And there's one of 3D issues, and there's again Joe in the upper left corner addressing the audience. And you can see this is a recurring trope of Joe's to have direct communication with his readers. So the 3D craze was one of the crazes in the 50s that was taking over, in a sense, the thrills that comics used to provide. In the 1950s, you had in the pop culture at the time genres like that are all represented in this one ad: the car, the rocket, science, technology that was going to take us to the stars, speed, the rocket. And somebody up at DC Comics, we don't know who it was, in 1956 decided to say, let's take one of our old characters, our old superheroes from the 40s, who hadn't been published for 5 years, and let's bring him back in 1956, but not the same way. Let's do him differently. And that was the Silver Age Flash. Why is it called the Silver Age? As soon as this was born, young historians looked back and said, well, there used to be superheroes in the 40s, that's the Golden Age. This will become the Silver Age. And Joe Kubert was there right at the beginning, because though he didn't pencil this, his peer Carmen Infantino penciled the Flash, but Joe Kubert inked the first issue. Now, we talk about in pop culture rebooting, everything's getting rebooted. The Silver Age Flash is the first example in American pop culture of what you would call a reboot, and that's what made it successful. It wasn't the same exact Flash, it was different, it had a new identity. And that kicked off what DC did in the late 50s, was take their mothball 1940s superheroes, like Green Lantern, who had your typical baggy superhero outfit based on a magician's cloak, and the artist Gil Kane would update it in 1959 to give it that sleeker, skin-tight look. Another one of their 1940s heroes, the Atom, nothing to do with microscopic power. He was just a little guy that was super strong. So Gil Kane brought him back in 1961 as the microscopic, scientific Atom. And just like in the 1940s, DC would bring all their superheroes together in All-Star Comics, and they were called the Justice Society. So too, did editor Julius Schwartz bring them all together as the Justice League of America? Well, there was one 1940s DC superhero that hadn't been rebooted, and that was, of course, Joe Kubert's Hawkman and Hawkgirl. How are they going to be retrofitted to fit this new Justice League of America? Well, the answer was found in the very title that DC brought back to Justice League of America. And look at the banner on top. It was a tryout title called Brave and Bold, meaning every couple issues they'd try something out new, and if it sold well, they would give it its own title. Well, look in the very first issue of Brave and Bold. There's a character, the Viking Prince, and this was drawn by Joe Kubert. DC Comics was one of the few houses left in the late 50s that artists could go and find work. So Kubert went back to DC and found work there. When you look at his Viking Prince in the late 50s, you can see elements of his tour work from a decade before. But it's Viking Prince, as it goes on, in which the mature style of Joe Kubert begins to emerge. Various artistic tropes, like the foreground characters and monochromatic color schemes, you begin to see in the Viking Prince work. Here's a little later on. What you know of as the Joe Kubert style is what begins to emerge in the early 60s with Viking Prince. And this kind of sword and sorcery character who dealt with, you know, medieval instruments was perfectly suited for the new Hawkman that Kubert would then draw, that debuted in 1961 in Brave and Bold number 32 with that cover. Here it is in its original black and white. And we're going to be looking at a lot of Kubert's black and white work to appreciate the black and whiteness of it before and how he used color. Now, that's the first time we see Hawkman and Hawkgirl. Here's the model sheet that Kubert prepared back in 1959, 2 years before it saw publication. So maybe DC Comics was waiting for sales results on Green Lantern and Atom before they gave the go-ahead. We don't really know because Julius Schwartz is no longer alive. But I used that model sheet and ghosted it behind the type in my intro. Just recently, God bless the internet, because I think Heritage Auctions just put this up. These are the original model sheets that Kubert did of Hawkman, and you can see how detailed they were, and obviously we're missing a part of Hawkman's head. But in the comic book, here's how they first appear in this three-panel sequence. And one of the things I want you to notice is the amount of black that Kubert used in his work, specifically in ostensibly superhero work. Because the DC Comics superhero of the day, everything took place in daytime. Superman, look at this image of Infantino's The Flash on a bright day just like today. Whereas Kubert's Hawkman, a lot of it took place at night. Now this is a detail from one of the spreads in my book, and I've got Mike Vosburgh, the head of a 1963 fanzine that was petitioning DC Comics to give DC Hawkman his own title. And Mike Vosburgh ended up becoming a professional comic book artist. But I quoted him where he said, Kubert used a lot of blacks and a lot of rendering to create a very dark and mysterious look to those work. Those Hawkman issues are very, very moody. They really show the influence of film noir. And you could see it in beautiful panels like this, where Kubert really showed his expressionism and his ability to show more with less. Look at this classic cover of Kubert's Hawkman and his innovative Shadow Thief. Look at how graphic that character is, and look at how he developed it for color. Here's another Hawkman cover. There were two three-issue tryouts in 1961 and then in 1962. But you can see Kubert's work looks great in color, but it also works beautifully in black and white. His splash pages with Hawkman begin to develop that airiness on the page, that sense of depth that we would see years later in the decade in his Enemy Ace work, which we'll see later in the presentation. Look at this splash page based in pen and ink with comic book color, but look at how Kubert transformed it to one of the greatest comic book covers of all time, which was done in pencil, and then the head of DC coloring named Jack Adler would come in and watercolor it, essentially. And Jack Adler worked with a lot of DC artists in the early 60s. Here's a cover he did with Kubert on the Viking Prince that preceded the Hawkman cover. Look at this classic Gil Kane Green Lantern cover that Adler did the wash tones for. This is the very first comic book cover I saw when I was 5 years old, was this cover that Adler did the Washingtons. Might be the single greatest Superman drawing ever done by Kurt Swan. But it's that Hawkman cover that I love, I think, most of all those Washington covers. In my book, on one double page spread, I try to collect all the Hawkman images I've just been showing you, along with Joe's own words that help illuminate why he did what he did. Now, there was another artist that did Hawkman at DC Comics that followed Kubert. He was actually too busy to do Hawkman on a regular schedule because of how much of the war comics he was doing. So another great DC artist named Murphy Anderson did Hawkman. And to this day, trying to discuss who did the better Hawkman is trying to discuss who's the better James Bond. But in my mind, I would consider Murphy Anderson the Roger Moore of Hawkman to the Sean Connery of Joe Kubert. Now, no offense, because I love Murphy Anderson, but that's subject for a whole nother lecture. But Kubert would return to Hawkman periodically as the 60s went on to do covers, and every cover he did was just brilliant. It was as if Connery would return to do James Bond every now and then to remind us that he's still the best Bond. Once again, look at how it looks in black and white. The Gray Ghost was a 1940s Hawkman villain that they brought back into the Silver Age. And Kubert obviously liked to draw him because he would return to the Gray Ghost multiple times in his career. Look at this great calendar image he did in the mid-70s. Whenever Kubert would return to Hawkman, it was always a cause to celebrate, because whatever he drew, however he drew Hawkman, he could draw Hawkman upside down and spinning around, and it still looked great, because nobody could draw Hawkman like Joe Kubert. He teamed him up with Superman. I think this was in the early 80s, I think. But, you know, you wouldn't normally associate Joe Kubert with Superman, but every now and then, Kubert would do Superman and remind us that, hey, he did a pretty good Superman. Now, as a little tangent, everybody's familiar with the great Neil Adams Superman Muhammad Ali image that was published in 1978. Here's the black and white inked version, and here is his pencil version. Now, is that Neil Adams' composition? No. He worked over Joe Kubert's original pencil and ink version that Kubert did to show the Muhammad Ali people. They didn't like Kubert's style. They didn't like the fact that the celebrities in the audience didn't look like real celebrities. They didn't think that his version of Ali looked enough like Ali. So Neil Adams ended up getting the job. But Neil liked Kubert's layout so much that he basically kept to it. And you can see it on this tighter version of Joe's pencil and ink image. Anyway, the same year that Superman and Muhammad Ali was published, Kubert again returned to Hawkman in a series of three covers for their revived showcase title, once again showing us all who the great Hawkman artist was. And in the ensuing decades, every now and then, Joe would return to Hawkman, and it was always a treat. This is one of the last Hawkman images he did, working on the tinted paper. And Joe loved this medium. There's more images in this lecture of them. But look at how that image was turned into the cover of the last publication that he worked on before he passed away in 2012. And there was a brand new Hawkman and Hawkgirl story. And you could see that even though, you know, Kubert was older, you can still see the same beauty and joy in his Hawkman work that he had at the end of his life, that he had at the very beginning of his life. And I think Joe would be happy to know that somehow or another, he is the reason why there is a Hawkman and a Hawkgirl on TV right now on the CW as part of that show. And that's a testament, I think, to the Kubert Hawkman. My favorite image of Hawkman was another one of his images on tinted paper. And if you come in closely on that figure, you can see that that's the Hawkman face I used for my combined image here. Now, of course, the next character we have to talk about is his next most definitive character right there in the center, and that would, of course, be Sergeant Rock, shown in this image I think he did in 1999. Out of all of his characters, it's probably Sergeant Rock, of course, that Kubert is most identified with. This was the biography that was put out a couple of years ago. Great if you haven't read it. Sergeant Rock appears in the DC Comics war title, Our Army at War, with the combat happy Joes of Easy Company. This is in the early 60s. He appears in 1959 in a story called The Rock and the Wall. The cover was not by Kubert. I think that's Irv Novick. And there's the splash page. This is Joe Kubert's, again, his not fully mature style yet. It doesn't, the mature style doesn't really appear until the mid-60s or so. But in the first story, you can see how he pictures Rock. That's the first time we see him. And then at the end of the story, the guy says, why do they call him the Rock of Easy Go? Because a wall may fall, Buster, but not a rock. And it's this grizzled countenance that we grew to knew and love that matured as Kubert's mature style grew into the grizzled face we see. And we all know that Kubert, Sergeant Rock, predates this guy, but there is always something of this guy in Sergeant Rock. Am I right? Yes, I'm right. Thank you. Anyway, that's the face I tried to capture when I used Sergeant Rock as his key portrait image, which was taken from this image in Kubert's mature style. Again, you don't even have to know what's going on in the story, but look at the excitement and the energy on this page. Look at his use of really the basic primary colors, which Kubert would return to over and over again to make his comic art come alive. Now, Kubert would be the first one to give his writer, partner, soulmate, Bob Kaniger, the credit on Sergeant Rock. Here is a portrait that he did of his partner and soulmate for the Comics Journal. But he says here in this double page spread in my book in the upper left corner, all the text is Kubert. And I matched it with the various images. But he says in the upper left corner that everything you see here is not the product of one person. It's really, Sergeant Rock comes out of Bob Kaniger's mind. I was just illustrating some really great stories. Well, Joe, as you know, was always quite modest. And you have to consider that in addition to the great writing, it is also the great artwork that makes comics work. So he was being gracious to give it to Bob Kaniger, but at the same time, Bob Kaniger gave it all to Joe Kubert. Look at the upper right corner. Kubert, as a graphic designer, was always pushing the limits of what a comic book cover specifically could do. So look at how he tries to make these two issues of Sergeant Rock look like actual books. And all of Kubert's covers were graphic, some more graphic than the others. But I chose this image because this is essentially what Sergeant Rock was about. It wasn't really glorifying war. It was all about war being hell. Look at one of his early Sergeant Rock covers. If that figure and that expression does not say war is hell, I don't know what is. The other theme of Kubert and Kaniger, Sergeant Rock, is essentially the split in human nature, especially in the Army, where our recruits, soldiers, or are they savages? Look at this graphic image that I took as almost the single keynote image of Sergeant Rock himself, and look at how that's about the soldier and the savagery behind him. Kubert was in the footsteps of the great anti-war comics of Harvey Kurtzman at EC a decade before. That is not a glorified picture of an American soldier. That is a soldier on the edge of death. And that's something that Kubert always captured in his Sergeant Rock work. This is maybe, I think, the single greatest Sergeant Rock story, but maybe the single greatest cover. Appearing in 1968, right at the beginning of the peak of the Vietnam War protesting. In my book, I turn this image into this double page spread with two other key issues from the era. That even though Sergeant Rock took place in World War II, just like the TV show MASH was about the Vietnam War, though it took place in the Korean War, so too did Kaniger and Kubert use Sergeant Rock to talk about what was happening in America in the late 60s. Now, this looks like a hippie. Even though it's World War II, there were no hippies. In the story, this guitar-loving soldier, you know, he's not into violence, man. He's into playing his guitar. Well, the combat-happy Joes of Easy Co. don't exactly cotton to a guy, a recruit, with a guitar instead of a rifle. But at the end of the story, he ends up sacrificing himself and killing the Nazis with his guitar and ends up getting killed himself. So Sergeant Rock and Easy Company bury him in this beautiful combination of love and death in a single image. Back to the spread, look at the image on the right, the New York Times Magazine cover from 1971 that highlights this story. That once again, even though it's a World War II story, if you look at what it's about, was torn from the headlines of the day, the 1969 Lieutenant Calley court-martial for the murder of Vietnamese civilians by American troops in 1969. So Kubert and Kaniger found a way to bring the issues of the day into Sergeant Rock. This is one of his single greatest stories that I chose to highlight in this presentation. And it's all about Sergeant Rock himself dying and the effect it would have on Easy Company. So it starts out, once again, another beautifully composed Kubert page that makes strong use of color as well as beautiful black and white comic art. But Sergeant Rock gets killed in the beginning of the story, or they think he was killed, obviously. And in this full page image that basically takes off on the cover image, you've got all of the Easy Company members wondering how they're going to go on without their fearless leader. Now, this rifle with the helmet motif is something that Kubert returned to in his war work over and over again. We'll get into more of the Unknown Soldier a little later. But back to that story, as the story goes on, Easy Company feels like they're haunted by the specter of Sergeant Rock himself, a ghost-like figure that helps them even though he's not physically there. And again, look at Kubert's manipulation of stylization, of not realism, to get across this idea of a ghost-like figure helping his crew members. And here's how the story ends, with Kubert, again, experimenting graphically with different types of pen and ink usages to get across different types of visualizations. Kubert always experimented with covers and with duotones and with color holds and graphic things, relentless as the years went on. And just like he would return to Hawkman, Kubert always would return to Sergeant Rock every now and then. I think the greatest time he returned to Sergeant Rock has to be when he did all the covers for G.I. Joe. I mean, I grew up with G.I. Joe. You grew up with G.I. Joe, right? But we all knew that there would be no G.I. Joe without Sergeant Rock, so I think it was really great that it came full circle and Joe got to do the packages. By the way, girls, for boys, this is our first boy doll, you know what I mean? Not that he cared, but whatever, just thought I would add that. Anyway, look at how he comes back to Sergeant Rock during the Gulf War and kind of shows the dichotomy and the paradox between the Gulf War and World War II. One of the last Sergeant Rock stories he did is one of his greatest, called The Prophecy, which takes place based on a real-life incident about, it takes place in Lithuania, in Vilnius, and this is where the Nazis stormed across and destroyed all the Jewish communities. And the story deals with the remnants of a messianic order of Jews that believes that the child that they're protecting is the coming Messiah. So it's interesting that Kubert would come full circle like this with the face of a baby and the face of the grizzled Sergeant Rock on the cover of one of the Prophecy issues that was done a decade or two after this image that I ended up using in my collage image here. In the bottom left corner, who is that character? That's taken from this cover. Very striking. That's, of course, Enemy Ace, the World War I German flying ace. Once again, look at the beautiful black and white art of that cover. Maybe Kubert's single greatest cover, and look at it just in black and white, but look at the use of the primary colors in the color version. This comes out in 1968. I'm 10 years old. I'm a superhero zombie like everybody else. I remember looking at that issue. I never bought a war comic. I only bought superheroes. But I remember holding that issue in my hands, staring at it. It was mesmerizing. But I remember the superhero zombie in me was saying, Arlen, you can't buy that issue. It's not a superhero. It's a war comic. But I remember it was so great, it wanted me to buy it, but I remember putting it down and not buying it. I only came to appreciate Kubert later on. When I was a kid, he didn't do superheroes. I didn't really get into Kubert. But Enemy Ace appears in Sergeant Rock's Our Army at War in 1965. and a backup story. And we begin to see that it's about this World War I flying ace. And look at the first page there with Kubert's trademark triple panel buildup. That, again, with the writing for Bob Kaniger, Kaniger wrote to Kubert's strengths. And you could see, once again, the color scheme Kubert's using, pure primaries, red, yellows, oranges. And then you turn the page and you get that full scene where you feel the depth of the sky. Now, why was enemy ace even begun? Well, around 1964, there was a lot of interest in the Red Baron. Books were starting to get written about him. And it sort of entered the consciousness, this idea that a World War I German could sort of be appreciated as a great aerialist, as a great pilot. And then, of course, in 1965, Charles Schulz comes up with the Red Baron and Snoopy. Now, for many of us, that's where Peanuts jumps the shark when he lets Snoopy take over the strip with the Red Baron, but that's a subject for a whole other discussion. Bottom line is, Kubert and Kaniger's Enemy Ace appears in 65, but he was written and created really in 1964, before the whole Snoopy and the Red Baron thing. But it was in these stories that Kubert begins to exercise this feeling of space and dimension on the page. And this is really where I think Kubert artistically takes an entire leap forward with his Enemy Ace work. Because you can see in these double page spreads, I mean, you gotta really love to draw airplanes to make this thing work. But Kubert drew whatever you gave him. That generation, they were utilitarian. You want me to draw airplanes? I'll draw airplanes. Doesn't matter. But Kubert became an expert at it. And the feeling of depth and dimensions on these pages has really never been equal. Look at how he can then become stylized, and you get the feeling of warming your hands over a fire. We've all been there. But Kubert's able to pull it apart. Again, look at the simple coloring. Really just yellows and blues to get that feeling across. At the same time, he can change the color scheme and use red and get the feeling of winter in the snow. Look at this beautiful panel. It's maybe about 4 inches big in the printed comic. But when you blow it up this big, you know, you don't need Roy Lichtenstein to repaint comic book panels. You just need to take the actual panels and blow them up big, because art is big, and they looked like great art. But once again, forget computer coloring. This was done old school Ben Day hand-cut screens. And look at the great coloring that Kubert got, especially on his covers. The monochromatic stylization, I mean, you don't see stuff like this anymore. But Kubert was just paying homage to the great EC comics that were colored by Marie Severin a decade and a half before. Look at how he copies that color scheme for this great Enemy Ace cover, where you show the different planes. And, I mean, that takes balls to color monochromatically like that. But I would like to see more of that. Look at this beautiful image. All Kubert's using is red, yellow, and blue. And yet you get an incredible image full of depth. That's the image that IDW used for their artist editions. If you guys don't have these artist editions, you really have to save up and get them. I don't even buy color comics anymore. I save my money for these artist editions because you get to see Kubert's art in its black and white form, the size of the original art. You can almost feel Kubert's hand moving across the page, making those savage brush strokes and those organic pen lines that only Kubert made. Even though this is not black and white, it's almost black and white, and you can see in the progression of these panels at how abstract and yet how realistic Kubert could be in Enemy Ace in making clouds visually interesting, whether it was daytime or whether it was nighttime. And the experimentation that Kubert did with dry brush and various inking techniques, you could see in his Enemy Ace work. In my book, I add the text in comic book font of Kubert talking about what it was like to work with Bob Kaniger on Enemy Ace, and you could see that he always gives it back to the writer and says, Bob's stories turned and moved on the emotional aspects of the characters involved. That then caused the artist to plumb the depths of his concentration to create a graphic response to Bob's text. That is what all of us as artists must do with the assignment that's given to us, which is usually a verbal assignment in text, is how to make words come alive in comics, using visuals and words together. So we move on from Enemy Ace to the character on the top right. Of course, that's Tarzan. I am one of, I think, a lot of people who believe that it is Joe Kubert's Tarzan above anybody else's Tarzan. In live action, animation, two-dimensional art, doesn't matter. We believe Joe Kubert is the definitive Tarzan artist of all time. Now, when you go back and look at the original visual interpretation of Tarzan, I mean, this is from 1912, the very first book cover. The artist that's most associated with early Tarzan, of course, is the great comic strip creator Hal Foster, who starts out his career adapting Tarzan in the relatively early genre of comic book newspaper strips, when Sunday strips were almost printed about as big as this projection. But this is back when Sunday comics were about, you know, that big, and you can get that amount of detail. Hal Foster also did a daily black and white Tarzan strip. It's really the Sunday that he's most known for, even though, as you can see, he pretty much used a grid. And after he had done Tarzan up until, I think, 1936 or so, he wanted to own his own strip. And that's when he goes to do Prince Valiant. And that's where Hal Foster's mature style emerges. And it's with Prince Valiant that the Hal Foster of legend really takes form. But it's still his Tarzan that is what's set up. Because Tarzan, in many ways, is the first superhero. Everything comes out of Tarzan. And everything comes out of John Carter and Mars. Without Edgar Rice Burroughs, we wouldn't even be here today, probably. But after Hal Foster, the next definitive Tarzan artist is usually the man who replaced him, Bern Hogarth. Now, Bern Hogarth's Tarzan, again, he's got his fans. He did a very kind of exciting, energetic Tarzan. But there's something a little bit too preening, a little too perfect, a little too posy, a little borderline, almost homoerotic Tarzan that, no offense, but I mean, I see, you know, Tarzan should be a little more savage than that. In fact, I think out of all of Bert Hogarth's art, it's his jungle of vines and the flora and fauna that I think he was strongest at. I don't really care for these very kind of prissy, preening poses, if I might alliterate a little too much there. I don't really care. In the same way, I don't care for the artists that followed him on Tarzan. Russ Manning, one of the great comic artists. Listen, you had to be great to work on Tarzan. But I think Russ Manning's style was a little too slick, a little too clean. He was better suited for a science fiction strip like Magnus Robot Fighter, which he did in the early 60s for Gold Key Comics. Anybody a fan of Magnus Robot Fighter? Come on, you gotta love a guy in white go-go boots. Yes, Mike Finn. And what was the sound effect when he karate chopped the robot heads off? Oh, come on, screech! Boy, tough crowd. You know what I mean by tough crowd? Tough crowd. Okay, then you have this guy, Jesse Marsh, that worked on Tarzan in the comic books for the company Dell. And you look at his style, I find it, again, a little bland, a little antiseptic. But these Dell comics, and then eventually their sister company, Gold Key, they would use painted covers to make the covers look interesting, like this one. But then, of course, you'd open up the insides and you'd get Jesse Marsh. Now, if you're a Jesse Marsh fan, that's fine. This particular cover was the cover in 1972, right before the license shifted to DC Comics, and they requested Joe Kubert, the Edgar Rice Burroughs people, and they got him. And this issue appears, and then 1 month later, we get the Joe Kubert Tarzan. And you can see from the cover how much the influence of Hal Foster's Tarzan is in Kubert's Tarzan. And by the way, here's another IDW collection you have to get that reprints the first bunch of Tarzan stories. And you'll get that cover in its black and white original form before Kubert applies the color to it. And in this full page splash page image, pretty much all the elements of Tarzan's world are there. And that, to me, is the definitive Tarzan figure, from his knife cut haircut, you know, down to his shins. That's your definitive Tarzan. On the page, just like with Enemy Ace, Kubert was able to get the feeling of the immense vastness of the jungle and the space, the depth, and again, using pen and ink as well as color to give you that feel of depth. Look at the space and dimension in black and white in this incredible double page spread. Just look at the way Kubert composes these panels that really get across the flora and fauna of Tarzan's world in one page. Again, you strip it down in black and white and you can see how Kubert balances every page that he draws with the right amounts of black and white to give the whole page a pleasing look. And you could see how influenced he was by Hal Foster's original black and white drawings and the influence they had on Kubert's style, especially in this 9-panel gridded fight scene page in black and white and then in color. Whenever I used to look at this page, I used to think that Kubert was as much of a master of the fight scene as his peer Jack Kirby was over at Marvel Comics. The same facility with anatomy and energy and panel composition you can see in Kubert's work. Here's one of his great Tarzan fighting the apes image, and here is Kubert's thumbnail sketch. And you could see that even in the thumbnail sketch, how much of the energy of that final image is there. And that's a good study lesson for all of you aspiring artists out there. That's the whole point of thumbnails, is to try to capture the essence of the drawing that you then bring to finish. Inside that collector's edition was one of the few kind of double page spread posters. I still have this framed in my apartment. There's very few merchandised images of Kubert's work, unfortunately, out there. This is one of the few things you can get. I think Joe liked it so much because in this photograph I found on the internet, there is the Tarzan image right behind him. And now we see the alligators. That was, of course, one of the great beasts that Tarzan would fight, whether it was above the water or below the water. Kubert had a facility with animals like nobody else. I mean, all the jungle animals Tarzan fought were rendered with the same beauty and care and attention to detail and verisimilitude of these animals, even though at the same time, Kubert's art is not tight and overly rendered. That is the great paradox of Kubert's work, is that a tremendous amount of detail, but yet not fussy and over-rendered detail. He was able to truly show more with less. There's a double page spread with the elephant. This particular story, The Captive, is one of my favorite single, maybe the favorite single Tarzan story. Why? Because there's this double page spread where Tarzan is indeed a captive held by this jungle tribe, and he's about to get roasted over a spit. And Kubert builds up the tension in this double page spread where you feel like, what is Tarzan going to do? And in one desperate attempt, he yells for his elephant friend to come and save him, but he has no idea if the elephant will hear his jungle yell. But he feels at the end here, no use, there's no one to help me but myself. And when you turn the page, you get this image, which I believe is Kubert's single greatest Tarzan image. I think it's on a par with Steve Ditko's famous machinery above his head image that if you young people don't know about, you need to research and find out. Steve Ditko's greatest single Spider-Man image. But I would put up Kubert's pillar pulling out image. Look at the brush strokes on top there. Look at how free and loose they're done. There's not a lot of thinking, but there's a lifetime of thinking at the same time in those brush strokes. Okay, back to the jungle animals. We've gone through the lions. We've gone through the alligators. Now we got to the king of the jungle. How did Kubert take Tarzan and match him off against these jungle cats? He had a lot of great double page spreads with different variations on his cats. Look at the saber-toothed tiger. But Kubert's been doing the saber-toothed tiger back when he was doing Tor 20 years earlier. But in Tarzan, there's some incredibly great Tarzan fighting, you know, the great jungle cats. Once again, black and white, and then you get the beautiful color. This is from his very first Tarzan story, matching off against the giant black jaguar. A cover. The black lion. Regular lion. Wrestling the lion. Now, this lion in particular is closest to one of the very earliest Tarzan paintings on one of the pulp covers, which is an image that all the great Tarzan artists have returned to. So there's Hal Foster's Tarzan on the back of the lion. Here is, once again, Bernd Hogarth's very savage jumping on the back of the lion. And here's John Buscema's back of the lion, and he's the artist who replaced Kubert when Kubert left Tarzan in 75 and the license went over to Marvel Comics. And you can see how Buscema's Tarzan is very close to that early painted Tarzan there on the pulp cover. But I happen to think Buscema's Tarzan is basically just his Conan. I mean, I don't really see a lot of difference. The great artist Neil Adams, who did Conan as well, did his version of Tarzan after Kubert's as a series of really beautiful paperback paintings. Now, Adams fans maintain that these might be the definitive Tarzan, but who is the only artist that could critique Neil Adams' Tarzan? When Neil Adams showed Joe Kubert this sketch, only Joe Kubert could have put that sketch under a piece of tracing paper and told Neil Adams what he was doing wrong. Right? Only Joe Kubert could do that. And here's Joe Kubert's thumbnail sketch. I mean, this drawing is maybe this big for one of the artists after him on Tarzan. But you can see, even in the sketch, Kubert's Tarzan is inimitable. He even featured in one of those Treasury editions a how to draw Tarzan thing, which back in the day when there was no internet, no information, we didn't know what tools the artists used. Right, Mike? We used to die. What did they use? How did they make those marks on paper? India ink, Jalote pen, Bristol board. These were like Indiana Jones clues to like some secret treasure. But Joe was always giving us this information to us young artists. Now, of course, we would copy this. Could we ever make a drawing that looked like that? No, but it gave us hope. It gave us a way. It gave us a road to follow. But it is Kubert who, in the end, is the definitive Tarzan artist of all time. And that's the face I use in the upper right corner there. Now, in the upper left corner, we're left with Kubert's last definitive character, Ragman, who appears in 1976, right after Kubert is done with Tarzan. Now, what the hell is Ragman? Well, before we get to what Ragman is, once again, I was mesmerized by that cover because it was Kubert paying homage to himself 8 years earlier when he does the Ragman cover in 1976, also with black and white pen and ink in the foreground and an ink wash on the back. But Ragman is a superhero with a word we had never heard of, a tatterdemalion. Don't even ask me what the hell that is. Sounds like what it is, a tatterdemalion, I don't know. But he's a superhero made out of rags and fabric. And it turns out that it's based on the Garment Center in New York, where Kubert, as a young Jewish boy, grew up around. And Ragman is the son of a junkyard worker, and I don't know, something happens where all of his buddies who have all different talents, they're involved with the guy, who remembers the story? They're involved with the gangsters, and they're all on the ground, and they get electrocuted, and somehow the electrocution goes through the guy's hand, and he gets all the powers of the kids. Bottom line is, he becomes Ragman. We didn't care, because Ragman looked cool as hell. In fact, it looked like Kubert doing his kind of Batman. Now, we remembered back in the 60s, during the dawn of the Batman TV show, when Kubert actually drew Batman, which was very rare. Kubert never drew Batman. But in early 1966, regular Batman artist Infantino was so busy doing promotional artwork for the TV show, like this image, that for a couple months he couldn't do his regular Batman duties, so editor Julius Schwartz got Kubert to draw Batman. Now, a lot of Batman fans are split on these. Some people hated him, some people loved him. The bottom line is, we were all hoping one day, after these three covers appeared, that one day Kubert would actually draw Batman. Well, he never really did, but we got Ragman. And Ragman, in this story that Kubert penciled and inked, it was basically Kubert getting to do Batman. And it was cool as hell. And like I said, Kubert didn't do many superhero stories, so these were treasured by us who love when Kubert would kind of do a superhero every now and then. Here's a beautiful story that's silent, that's told just in pictures about gangsters coming to raid a cemetery filled with, you know, jewels or something like that. And of course, Ragman comes along and just using pictures defeats the enemy. Anyway, it was one of the DC Comics that came and went, but people loved Ragman. There was something about Ragman that was captivating. And a couple years ago, one of the teams at DC Comics decided to tie Ragman's Jewish heritage of being it from the rag trade, the shmata trade as it was called, to tie it in with Jewish history and make Ragman be a kind of a vessel to hold this kind of meditation on the Holocaust. Now, if you think about that seed in Kubert's work, you can see it even in his war comics in the 60s. Covers like this were not overtly about Jewish prisoners. Nobody's wearing a yarmulke. They don't have the stripe thing. Maybe they're just generic European refugees. But Kubert was trying to get his Jewish background into his stories at a time when you really couldn't do it. So in the early 70s, this Unknown Soldier story has a Jewish theme to it, which you can see by the final three panels when Kubert shows the Jewish star at the end of the story. There were a couple issues of this oddball DC war comic in the mid-70s. Did these actually get published? I never saw them. They were like, what, three issues? It was, once again, like Enemy Ace was from the German point of view in World War I. Blitzkrieg was even more daring. It was really war stories told from the Nazi point of view, right? I never saw them, and maybe that's why. I think they came and went because nobody wants to see stories told from the Nazi point of view. But the point I'm showing is that Kubert was able to get his Jewish themes overtly now into the stories. Kubert never forgot his Jewishness. For years, he did this strip about two Jewish kids for Moshiach Times, printed in Brooklyn, I think. Does anybody know the background of... Anyway, he did this Jewish strip that would talk about Jewish history, and Kubert would draw this, and I think he did it, whether he was paid or not, I don't know the details, but this was something he did for years, and they were recently collected. One of his great graphic novels that Kubert did about a decade ago was Yassel, his Holocaust graphic novel. And it was done all in pencil on that tinted gray paper, and some of Kubert's most sensitive drawings. But it's not what you would call, if there is such a thing, as a typical Holocaust novel, because Kubert decides to tell the story from the kid's point of view, except the kid is Kubert himself as a fantasy, because his family escaped Poland, I think in 1939, right before it was too late to get out. And Kubert often wondered, had his family not escaped, had he stayed in Poland, what might have happened to him? And Yassel is a beautiful graphic novel that supposes, had Kubert stayed, what might have happened to him trapped in the Warsaw Ghetto. And that's what these images are about. And if you haven't read Yassel, you really should. This is an image Kubert did that was separate from Yassel, but was a part of Yassel. So somehow in all this work, there's a seed for it in Ragman, and that's why Ragman has kind of proved the test of time and remains a viable character for exploration, and that's the character I used in the figure here. So remember I told you we would get back to that autobiographical story about Kubert and drawing his whole family? Because there's his family in 1968, and there's Adam, and there's Andy, right now. Now, look at Andy, pretty much the same age, and there's Father Joe teaching him how to draw. And lo and behold, here's Andy doing the reverse. I found this off the internet. Every time on Facebook I see this image, I'm like, I'm gonna use that in the lecture on Friday. But there's Andy doing what Joe is doing to him, and that brings us, of course, to where we are, the Joe Kubert School. Because in the mid-70s, after Kubert had that long career at DC Comics, he wanted to give back, and he remembered the struggles he faced as a kid growing up, and looking for work. Remember I showed this image early on in the presentation? And remember, Kubert was the one who in the 60s, in his comics, would give us pages like this that were like the Holy Grail for young artists. We didn't have a store that sold comic art supplies, but it was pages like this where we first learned what India ink was and things like that. So somehow Kubert took his joy in comics, his love of education, his wanting to give back, and he comes up with, here's one of the early ads for the Joe Kubert School, which of course, before 1985, was in what was called the mansion. I found this image off the internet. God bless the internet, but there it is. And then of course in 1985, I had no idea it was that long ago. I thought it was much more recent, but you moved into this building, which is where, of course, we are today. Now, Joe was always teaching. Here's a picture I found. But of course, it was really the emergence of his sons, Adam and Andy. And I'm gonna show you now a list of alumni that have come from this school. And obviously, this is nowhere near a complete list. But first of all, let's just talk about Adam and Andy. I mean, what a beautiful thing that Joe's sons would go on to become not only teachers here, but great comic book artists of their own right without slavishly imitating their father's style. Adam Kubert and Andy, they've both done only the top characters from Marvel and DC. That was Adam's X-Men. Here's one of his most recent Batman drawings. Also on that great tinted paper that Joe himself loved. There's Andy doing Batman recently. And there's Andy doing Superman. So I mean, you really, it's hard to find that in the rest of pop culture, to find sons that have gone on to achieve such, you know, lofty heights, not being slavish imitations of, you know, their parent. It's hard to find that. And I think that's a testimony to Joe that encouraged their individualism. At the same time, he encouraged them, in a sense, to follow their artistic dreams. Here's a portrait Neil Adams did after Joe passed of just some of the Kubert alumni that have come out since 1976 when the school started. Now I remember 1976, I was a high school senior about to go to art school and I ended up going to Rhode Island School Design, but that was the first year the Kubert School started and I remember hearing about it, but I ended up going to RISD. I guess, you know, the Kubert School was starting, it was maybe too new for me to even apply to it. But in 76, Joe put out this publication and I remember buying it, and I remember seeing this list of names, and I recognized all the names, but I didn't recognize this name, Bissett. But Steve Bissett was one of the first noteworthy Kubert School grads when he and one-year student John Totleben combined in the early 80s to work on Swamp Thing with the great English author Alan Moore, which basically revolutionized comics in the same way that Stan Lee and Jack Kirby revolutionized comics in the early 60s. And it was Steve Bissett's and Totleben's pencil and ink work that really made the title shine and really put the Kubert School on the map when everybody found out they were Kubert School graduates. Bissett has gone on to be a teacher. He did his own comic book Tyrant. So in alphabetical order, I'm just gonna go through just some of the great Kubert alumni. You have Amanda Connor, maybe one of there's not that many strong female artists in mainstream kind of superhero comics, but she's maybe the best. This is from her great story, A Pro, about a prostitute who gets superpowers. If you haven't read it, it's really one of the funniest comic book stories ever. There's Kim DeMolder, hey. Fantasy hey. Artist. Hey. Isn't he a teacher here? Yeah. Is he here? No? Okay. Well, there you go. Dave Dorman, who became a fantasy painter. And again, the Kubert alumni have worked on all of the top media projects. Here's another Star Wars project by Jan Dersima. Am I pronouncing that correctly? Jan Dersima. You have Jay Geldof, penciler and inker and colorist, did a lot of great, Grendel work, forgot that. You have Alex Maleev, who really innovated a really great artistic style. He's really one of the top artists working today. Tom Mandrake did a great scene. Rags Morales, Superman. Graham Nolan, who created Bane. Right. Hold your applause till the end, yeah.
Okay, you got Dan Parent, one of the great Archie artists, leading Archie into the future. You have a good friend of mine, Steve Pinella, who's a graphic designer, but he always loved comics, just came out with Faith Fallon, a black and white graphic novel that's being serialized. And, you know, he's manipulating three-dimensional model art and various things, not traditionally drawing, but you can see that he learned how to tell stories at the Kubert School and combining it with graphic design and computer graphics. You should really check out this Faith Fallon, very innovative visually. And spoiler alert, I wrote the introduction to the first issue because I was a big fan of it when I saw it a couple years ago. I was like, Steve, you got to get this published. And he just got it published. So I feel like a little bit of a proud father that I was one of the first people that recognized it. Fernando Ruiz. Yeah, Bart Sears. He's done a lot of stuff. You know, these are images I found off the internet that were like, you know, the biggest DPI I could find. But because all of these artists have done multiple projects. Excuse me, Eric Schanauer did an incredible series called The Age of Bronze about the Trojan Wars. You've got Timothy Truman, who was again one of the first graduates, I think, in the same class as Bissett. And he did a series of kind of new Hawkman stories called Hawk World. You've got Rick Veitch, who penciled and inked and wrote a couple of great graphic novels. Brat Pack is maybe the greatest graphic novel about kid sidekicks in a way you've never seen kid sidekicks portrayed before. He also did a kind of a trippy, psychedelic graphic novel called The One. And once again, look at this cover, and you could see that he was really just doing a riff on what his mentor Joe had done 25 years earlier. You've got Ron Wagner, who's worked on G.I. Joe, and you've got the great, one of my favorite artists, Lee Weeks, who's done a lot of stuff, and this is just one of his most recent pieces. And then you've got this guy, relatively new, and his name is Orion Zangara. And here is his just brand new graphic novel. And why am I highlighting? First of all, his name begins with Z, so he's the last one on the list. But what's interesting about Orion Zangara is he happens to be Joe Kubert's grandson. So it's interesting that the generations are now continuing and going on. And what was Joe doing all this time while all these great alumni were doing their great works and becoming known? In addition to teaching, Joe was nonstop on that drawing board all these decades doing some incredible graphic novels that were taken from his own life. He did a series of two graphic novels, Abraham Stone, Country Mouse, City Rat. And you can see that just in the artwork here, translated I think into Italian or something here, but you can see that Kubert drew upon growing up in New York City with these things. And you could see the kind of low-level gangsters from the early part of the century that Kubert did in a related graphic novel called Jew Gangster. With this, I love this cover with the monochromatic color scheme. Now, this is a photograph of the elevated train from the 1930s where Kubert was a child growing up. But you could see how lifelike Kubert was able to bring that look into this incredible double page spread, right? You just said, wow, I caught that. Wow, right? That's what I'm talking about. Now, this isn't a great image, it's all I could find, but this is the Israeli Museum of Caricature and Comic Art, and they had a great exhibit of Kubert's work maybe about 10 years ago or so, and this is the only picture I could find, but they did a whole display about Jew Gangster. And here is a Sergeant Rock display. And I love how none of this exists in America, where they don't just take the black and white art and stick it on the walls. They actually create three-dimensional dioramas built around the art, so you feel like you're walking into an immersive comic art experience. There should really be museums like this here, but that's a whole other story. But going from Israel to around the world, one of Joe's great graphic novels, Fact from Sarajevo, was taken from real life about his friendship with a guy over in Bosnia and the struggle that he was going through and the faxes he was sending to Joe, Joe turned into one of his great graphic novels. But I highlighted this image to show you, once again, Kubert's facility with the human figure and the amount of gesture and characterization he can get in just the way he drew that woman's eye right there almost tells the whole story of her emotion. But that was Kubert also with the way he did Yassel at the same time. The humanity that you see in Kubert's work. Here's another graphic novel that he did about Vietnam, only about maybe, what, 10 years ago, or less than 10 years ago, he did this, called Dong Chai, based on a real story about Vietnam. At the end of his life, Kubert was able to return to one of his legacy characters, Sergeant Rock, and actually kill Sergeant Rock off. And it happened in this story, where it says here that Easy learned later that the bullet that took out Sergeant Rock was the last shot fired in the war. I'd sure like to remember it that way. Yeah, it just seems appropriate somehow. And it is appropriate that when Kubert died in 2012, I mean, he was drawing right up until the time he died when the lights finally went out in 2012. A year later, John Cook of Comic Book Creator Magazine came out with this memorial issue where he asked for people to send in their reminiscences of Joe. You can see the title is Creator and Mentor, because that's what Kubert was. He was both an incredible mentor right here at the school, but leave us never forget what an incredible creator he was as well. And you can see in this autobiographical image that he shows here. And what is the concept here at the end here in the text? What is this mysterious place? The place is the Kubert School of Cartoon and Graphic Art. And the man is the one and only Joe Kubert. And those twin things of mentorship and creatorship are what remain here at the Joe Kubert School. I fail to see the humor in that. So back to this issue, obviously the cover was inspired by that classic Sergeant Rock cover, and it was a Sergeant Rock cover that I was inspired by, this one, to do my contribution to that issue, which all I could kind of steal were 6 pages. Had he given me 16, I would have filled them up. I started out with 1 page, and I begged for as many as I could get. I got 6. So with 6 pages, I was able to do a takeoff on that and call it Joe Kubert's 5 comic stars, because when I looked out at all of the characters that Kubert created or drew, I mean, how do you pick only as many as I could fit? I only had 6 pages, so those were the 5 I chose. And just like in my Silver Age book, when you turn the page, I've innovated this kind of combination words and images, verbal visual essays I call them, and you can see all the images and many of the words that I spoke to you today in these double page spreads. So I tried to draw a parallel between Tarzan and Sergeant Rock, just like that cover drew the parallel. You turn the page, you get this double page spread where I show Ragman and Batman together and show you the corresponding images. And then for the final page, remember my favorite Hawkman image, I took that image, I scanned it in, I cleaned it up, and I added the 6 issues that Kubert did. All he ever did were 6 issues of Hawkman in 1961 and 62. And yet, those 6 issues are still considered the definitive Hawkman. But for the final word on Joe, we must give it to his soulmate, Bob Kaniger, who once said, "From his pen came the sound and the fury, the loneliness, the silence, the exhaustion, the pity and the pitiless, the poetry and the mud, black and white more eloquent than erupting blood. It was a miracle called Joe Kubert." Thank you very much.